typhoon Ampere is bearing down on the eastern part of the Tokyo area, forcing the cancellation of hundreds of flights and trains. Capital is expecting heavy rain and strong winds. This tourist expressed his frustration.
Right now it's starting to build due to the typhoon, and my next step is to go back to the hotel I was staying at previous, so I can book a room there for the night, and then maybe try to travel to Osaka tomorrow.
Minister, and even two of his far-right cabinet members who usually support the settler movement. Israelis, Palestinians in the West Bank experience attacks on a daily basis, and no one is ever punished.
These actions are in line with the trend. You see Israeli settlers attacking cities, attacking villages, burning down cars, attempting to burn down homes, shooting Palestinians. 18 have been killed by Israeli settlers in the past 10 months. In none of these incidents has any settler been held to account. And in many of the cases, you had members of the cabinet cheering on the settlers. And the Israeli army is always close by, providing them with protection.
The White House says the Israeli government must take action to stop this settler violence. Yolande Nell in Jerusalem told me more about the incident, which the Israeli president described as a pogrom.
I was hearing from a man whose property was damaged in this village of Jid, close to Nablus, after dark last night. He said cars were set on fire at first, and then houses. You can actually see that in some of the social media video. He said that residents in this village went out when they first saw a dozen or so settlers who were there, but very quickly numbers increased, and he said that there were easily more than 100 of these extremist settlers, most of them masked. It's been described as a pogrom, what happened there, by the Israeli president, who condemned it, saying this was an extreme minority. Of course, all settlements are seen as illegal under international law, but the settlers who have been seen as responsible are an extremist group that seems to have been emboldened by the ongoing tensions. The UN agency OCHA recently came out with its figures documenting, it said, more than 1,250 secular attacks against Palestinians. We've also had at the same time a big expansion of Israeli settlement activity under the current hardline government that includes key ministers who are known for being pro-settlement, and this has led to the displacement of something like 1,400 Palestinians from their homes because of settler harassment.
Why are we seeing then this right-wing government criticising these settlers when these attacks have been going on for some time?
I think there is an awareness of the fact that there are cases going on in international courts at the moment. There have been steps taken by the US and other Western allies of Israel to sanction extremist settlers. I mean, there's a real consciousness in the international community that the situation is highly combustible.
Yeah, is this latest incident worse than what's happened before?
We have seen deadly attacks on Palestinian civilians before. I think here the timing is also, of course, extremely sensitive. You know, this took place in the evening as Gaza ceasefire talks began in Qatar, being presented very much by the US and other mediators, Qatar and Egypt, as sort of last-ditch attempts to get a ceasefire for Gaza that could bring home dozens of Israeli hostages believed to still be alive, held by Hamas in Gaza. We were told by the White House they'd got off to a promising start. Those are expected to continue today, with an Israeli delegation present in Doha to meet the mediators. Hamas has not sent its own delegation, but of course its political leaders who live in exile are nearby, and there is a big hope now of a deal that could avert the growing threat of a wider regional war.
Yolande Nell in Jerusalem. It is known as Snowball Earth, the longest and deepest ice age in our planet's history. Exactly how it came about has long been a mystery, but a small group of Scottish islands may have the clue to understanding it. This report from our science correspondent, Palab Ghosh.
These tiny islands in the Inner Hebrides of Scotland hold the key to how the first animal life emerged on Earth hundreds of millions of years ago. Each layer of rock face and Garvelax captures a snapshot of the planet's distant past. Scientists have now dated fragments of the rock and shown them to be from the only place in the world to have a detailed record of how our planet plunged into the most severe and prolonged ice age in our history. These tiny grains prove beyond any doubt that the Garvelax are the best and most complete record of a critical period in our history called Snowball Earth, when for 80 million years, pretty much the entire planet was covered with ice. If we wind back the calendar hundreds of millions of years, we see that Scotland was in a completely different place because the continents have moved over time. It was south of the Earth's equator and had a tropical climate, until it and the rest of the planet became engulfed in ice. But then, something remarkable happened.
After the melting of the snowball, we suddenly start to get bona fide modern-looking animals.
It seems counterintuitive that such a big freeze that could have prevented life was actually a spur to generate this explosion of life.
After the snowball melted, of course, everything that had adapted to that and diversified in those specialist niches would have had to then compete with each other in some kind of arms race.
Geologists have been studying the rocks and the Galvalax for decades, first on foot and more recently using drones to create detailed computer-enhanced images of the rock layers. If the results are confirmed, these islands could be awarded a golden spike. That's an actual spike hammered in to celebrate the location of a planet-changing geological moment. Elias Ruggen imagines what it might be like to receive one of science's greatest accolades.
It would be fantastic. Golden spikes around the world are reasonably big deals. The previous one that was ratified was some 30 years ago, so it doesn't happen that often.
Do you think you'll get it?
I'm hoping so. It's definitely the leading candidate. I don't think there's many other layers of rock and sections around the world that come close, so I'm quite confident, yeah.
Researchers will find out next year whether they and Scotland have won the Golden Spike. But in the meantime, they press on with their research, studying the rocks that hold the key to the emergence of the first complex life on Earth.
You're listening to the news from the BBC World Service. Hundreds of flights have been grounded in Japan as Typhoon Amphil moves towards the Tokyo region. The storm, classified as very strong, the second highest, is situated off the Pacific coast of Japan's main island. Bullet trains have been cancelled and tens of thousands of people told to evacuate. Our Asia-Pacific regional editor, Kitsia Sala, reports.
Hundreds of thousands of Japanese travellers were hoping to make their way home at the end of the Obon holiday, one of Japan's three major holiday seasons. Typhoon.
In 1,000 feet, turn left onto Pennsylvania 104 South, South 10th Street.
Train service between Tokyo and Nagoya has been suspended for the day. Japan Airlines and All Nippon Airways have cancelled over 600 flights to and from Tokyo.
Turn left onto Pennsylvania 104 South, South 10th Street.
Typhoon Amphil is now forecast to head towards the eastern region of Kanto, skirting past the Japanese capital, Tokyo.
Continue on Pennsylvania 104 South for 9 miles.
In areas close to the city. The typhoon is expected to bring heavy rain to the region and to back winds of over 160 kilometers an hour. The Japan Meteorological Agency says the winds will be strong enough to overturn a moving truck and has warned residents to take precautions against flying objects. The agency has classified the storm as very strong, one of two higher categories of typhoons. Authorities urged people to stay indoors and warned of the possibility of mudslides, high waves, and flooding.
That's been a problem almost since the dawn of mountaineering. What to do about all the rubbish that accumulates on Everest? Nepal has announced it will deploy Chinese drones in the next few months to pick up rubbish from the world's highest mountain. Let's talk to a global environment correspondent, Navin Singh Khadka. Tell us first the scale of the problem.
Well, it's known to everyone by now. It's massive. We don't actually know, but we're talking about hundreds of tons. I mean, you know, just recently we did this story about human excrement, for example. So I was told that, you know, there's 3 tons of human excrement between Camp 1 and Camp 4. So imagine what other things, all those canisters, gas cylinders, tents, everything in which it's a massive, massive thing. And that's why we see this yearly cleanup campaign every year, that we must be mindful that they happen only at lower camps, not at high camps.
Yeah, so how will this new scheme work with the drones?
So see, to understand this, we need to first understand that the ice fall, the first treacherous part during this mountaineering, mountaineers have to cross while ascending Everest. Now, this is becoming increasingly dangerous in the wake of climate change, particularly. That's why, if you remember last year and before that, the government of Nepal allowed helicopters to take all those ladders and ropes to Camp 1 from where climbers in this, when shoppers, when they bring back, or when people bring back trash, rubbish from Everest, it's still risky. So the drones can actually help. You can avoid carrying those heavy things when you are crossing that dangerous stretch. I'm told that in 1 hour, this particular drone, it's a heavy lifter, can carry above 230 kilos of trash in an hour, which is equalizing or coping to 14 quarters in 6 hours. So that's the kind of thing it's going to be quite helpful, they say. For now, it's camp one and camp two, higher camps still difficult.
But it does sound like this could be a game changer for clearing the rubbish on Everest.
Yes, that's what they're saying. They have tested this. Now, this year, this autumn season, they'll first do this in Amadablam. It's in the Everest region, another mountain, very famous mountain. And in spring, that's in March and April, this will happen on Everest. And yes, they will be bringing down all this trash using drones.
Gavin, many thanks indeed. Gavin Sinkatka there, global environment correspondent. Now, have you ever realised you've been using a well-known saying for ages, but actually getting it wrong? Perhaps you have referred to a damp squid rather than the correct term of damp squib. If so, you're not alone. The list of the top 10 misheard sayings in the English language have now been published, and Richard Hamilton has been taking a look.
A study of 2,000 adults in the UK found that 40% of them had been mishearing common sayings for years, around a tenth of their entire lives. The list of the 10 most misheard phrases has now been revealed, and the top ones are wriggle room instead of wiggle room, followed by escape goat when it should be scapegoat, nip it in the butt in place of bud, and tender hooks rather than tenterhooks. The reason why people get these words wrong is that they're often archaic terms which are no longer in use, but sound similar to current words. So, for example, a tenterhook was a nail dating back to the 14th century to stretch wool on a wooden frame called a tenter. A squib is an old name for a firework, and in the Bible, a scapegoat is one of a pair of kid goats that's released into the wilderness while the other is sacrificed. But does it really matter if we get these phrases wrong? Dr. Laura Bailey is an expert on linguistics at the University of Kent.
It's not really the end of the world if you get something wrong. You're still using a phrase to mean the thing that you mean it to mean. Sometimes, I suppose, a bit sad if you lose the original meaning of it by changing it. So you might lose the historical story behind the phrase's meaning. It might matter because it might make you a bit daft. So it might matter in terms of what other people think of you and make judgments about you. But sometimes I think it would be sad to lose the phrases or the actual meaning of the phrase itself.
In the list are words that sound the same, homophones, but differ in spelling, meaning, and origin, such as moot point, written with a U, instead of moot with two O's. A moot, by the way, is an old English name for a judicial court. Misheard words or phrases are known as malapropisms or eggcorns. Interestingly, or maybe confusingly, the word eggcorn is itself an eggcorn, as it's derived from the more common word acorn.
Richard Hamilton reporting. The dance music scene has a new star, a 72-year-old retired bookkeeper from Scotland. Tony Morris says that for half a century he considered himself a failure, as he was unable to find anything he was good at. That all changed just before lockdown when he discovered electronic dance music. His songs, which he recorded at home, are no longer than a minute because he gets out of breath easily. But the response in the music clubs of Glasgow and Edinburgh has been enthusiastic. And now he has a record deal with his first single about to be released. David Sillito has been to meet him.
In a quarter mile, turn right onto US 522 South, West Market Street. At the light, turn right onto US 522 South, West Market Street. Continue on US 522 South for 20 miles. South toward Southview Drive. Continue on US 522 South for 19 miles. On US 522 South toward Farmhouse Road.
assassination attempt at a rally in Pennsylvania of Donald Trump, where we saw him surrounded by security guards. There was blood streaming down the side of his face, and then that arm held defiantly in the air. And then very quickly after that, Mike, we saw Elon Musk post on X, "I fully endorse President Trump, and I hope for his rapid recovery." Why do you think he chose that moment to endorse Trump?
Well, I think it's most likely the reason that many other people threw their support behind Trump in that moment. You've painted such a compelling picture of the emotion that was running through there. Musk has steadily been moving towards an endorsement, I think, for months. And this was the point where Trump was receiving a whole lot of understandable sympathy. His campaign at that point had an almost inevitable air of success about it. As you say, Elon Musk's statement came just, you know, minutes after the shooting, and it kind of indicates to me that he was swept up with the emotion of the moment, like so many other people were.
So Elon called me. As you know, he endorsed me full-throated. Great endorsement. Respect Elon a lot. He respects me. Not easy for him to endorse, to be honest with you.
On US 522 South West Market Street toward Hetrick Road, Mulberry Alley. Continue on US 522 South for 12 miles. head west on US 522 South toward Boop Farm Lane. west on US 522 south toward North Stuck Street. Continue on US 522 south for 4 miles. West on US 522 South toward McCormick Lane. West on US 522 South toward Crestwood Lane. Continue on US 522 South for 1.5 miles. In a quarter mile, slight left onto Back Maitland Road. Make a slight left onto Back Maitland Road. Continue for 11 miles. Kepner Lane. Continue for 11 miles.
Outstanding
west on Back Maitland Road toward Snyder Hollow Drive.
The art of air pollution. Tuesday at 14 and 21 GMT. Or listen now wherever you get your BBC podcasts. In 60 minutes, the newsroom.
We hear about the anger in the occupied West Bank after Israeli settlers go on the rampage. Thailand gets its youngest ever prime minister. The secret of Earth's ice age as revealed by a group of Scottish islands. And escape goat, damp squid, and other misheard phrases.
This is the BBC World Service, the world's radio station.
Mixtape with me, Mubeen Azhar. A surprising advert appears in a number of British publications. Here's what it says.
Friendly, fatherless, 31-year-old female looking for intrepid male, 50s to 70s, who wants to try being a father figure, brackets, not sugar daddy, end brackets. Personal adventure, could be long-term, who knows? Email neverhadadad87@gmail.com.
Find out exactly what landed in George's inbox. And then to 80s El Salvador, where a rebel radio station emerges as the civil war rages.
On the night of January 10th, 1981, I was so excited as I took the microphone and with all my strength and energy said,
La Radio Venceremos.
Radio Venceremos has started broadcasting from the mountains of Morazan to accompany the social struggle that's launched today.
That's coming up after the BBC World Service News.
Thailand's new Prime Minister Patthongtong Chinawat says her government will have a strong and experienced team that aims to improve the lives of all Thais. The 37-year-old replaces Sitar Tewisin, who was dismissed earlier this week and becomes Thailand's youngest ever head of government. Addressing supporters, Ms. Patthongtong said she would work to move the country forward.
Talk to my family. I talked to a lot of people from my party, and I decided that it's about time to do something for the country and for the party as well. And I hope that I can do my best to make the country go forward. That's what I try to do. And right now, of course, today, I feel very honored and I feel very happy.
The Palestinian Foreign Ministry has denounced as organized state terrorism an attack by extremist Israeli settlers on a village in the occupied West Bank in which one Palestinian man was killed. With more details, here's Sebastian Usher.
The violent rampage by Israeli settlers in the Palestinian village of Jeet is the latest in a series of such attacks in the occupied West Bank. Dozens of settlers, some wearing masks, set cars and houses ablaze. The Palestinian authorities say that one man died of gunshots, while another was seriously wounded. The incident has drawn widespread condemnation in Israel. Even far-right ministers close to the settlers have denounced it. The U.S. ambassador to Israel has said that he's appalled and that such attacks must stop, with the criminals being held to account. In recent months, the U.S. has sanctioned several of the most extreme members of the settler movement.
The Israeli army has issued a new evacuation order for Palestinians in two areas of Gaza. The military also said the Israeli designated humanitarian zone would be further adjusted in response to intelligence that Hamas had established infrastructure there. It comes as talks in a ceasefire are due to continue. More from Yolat now.
We were told by the White House they'd got off to a promising start. Those are expected to continue today with an Israeli delegation present in Doha to meet the mediators. Hamas has not sent its own delegation, but of course its political leaders who live in exile are nearby. And there is a big hope now of a deal that could avert the growing threat of a wider regional war.
Officials in western Germany have lifted water restrictions after another case of suspected sabotage on supplies at a military base. Initial tests found no contamination, though investigations into the unknown perpetrators continues. The warning affected 10,000 people, as well as soldiers at a local army barracks. World News from the BBC. An advisor to President Putin has accused NATO countries of helping to plan the Ukrainian offensive into Russia. Russia's Kursk region, Nikolai Patrushev told a Russian newspaper the Ukrainians would not have ventured into Russian territory without the direct support of the West, but gave no evidence to support his claim. India's largest association of doctors has called for a nationwide withdrawal of non-emergency services on Saturday in protest at the rape and murder of a junior doctor in a Kolkata hospital last week. Over the past several days, thousands of medics in cities across India have been protesting on the streets calling for justice, as Ramana Gupta reports.
In a statement, the Indian Medical Association said it was time for the authorities to ensure the safety of doctors inside hospitals and campuses. A 31-year-old female doctor was found dead in the early hours last Friday at Arjikar Medical College. She had been resting in a seminar room during a 36-hour shift. One man has been arrested and charged with a crime, but protesters say that that's not enough. Widespread anger at the failure of tough laws to deter violence against women has fueled protests by doctors and women's groups across India.
The World Health Organization says 316 people have died in a cholera outbreak in Sudan. Over 11,000 cases have been reported, but the WHO warns the actual number could be higher. The outbreak follows heavy rains and flooding. Hong Kong is celebrating the rare birth of twin giant pandas to the oldest first-time mom in captivity. Ying Ying gave birth for the first time at the age of 19, the equivalent of 57 in human years. The giant panda conceived naturally with her partner Lily in March, but the pregnancy was kept secret. BBC World News.
Hello, you're tuned in to the Outlook Mixtape from the BBC World Service. I'm Mubin Azhar, serving you some of the tastiest treats from my last week on air. Today, we're concluding our season, Build Is Anybody Out There, where we've been sharing stories of secret communication and celebrating the ways people connect. Coming your way today, a British woman who put out an advert searching for a father figure.
It felt like there was a lot to unlock, that I still hadn't had the experience of having a father. And I knew I would be very restless and dissatisfied until I had at least just tried to get a taste, a proper taste of what that would be like.
And by the kitchen sink, a deep secret revealed by a mother to her daughter.
I know I went on to say, you can't understand, you will never know what I think and feel about this. And at that point, she's unwrapped and the oven glove or the tea towel was in. Down with force onto the kitchen counter, and that's what actually I do.
But first, earlier this week, Luis Morris took us back to the 1980s in the tiny Central American country of El Salvador, which at the time was in the midst of a bitter civil war. It was here that Carlos Enriquez Gonsalvi, a Venezuelan man better known to his listeners as Santiago, harnessed the power of radio, became the voice of the left-wing guerrilla station Radio Venceramos, which broadcast undercover and behind enemy lines for over 11 years.
I feel that history was being written in El Salvador, and that's why I decided to found a clandestine radio station in the mountains under attacks and bombardment.
Muchos dijeron que eso era imposible, que eso era una locura que había puesto del ejército.
Many said that this was impossible. It was madness, as there were army bases all over the country.
They weren't wrong. It was incredibly dangerous and would mean the team risking their lives to keep the station on the airwaves. But for Carlos, in those early days, it was a matter of necessity. With that in mind, the young activist and journalist set off from Nicaragua to El Salvador.
It was important for the public to have a means of communication at the onset of what would be a long civil war. During the time of dictatorship, journalists were being murdered, so this couldn't be anything other than a clandestine radio station.
Getting into the country with his mission undetected was easier said than done. Civilians and foreigners alike were often disappeared. The airport was guarded by soldiers.
Cuando yo llego al aeropuerto de San Salvador, pues lo hice con un gran nerviosismo, ¿verdad? Sentí miedo realmente.
I was really nervous when I arrived at the San Salvador airport. I was terrified because the dictatorship had been very bloody. In that very same airport, just a few weeks earlier, the army had captured four Catholic missionaries from the United States and raped and killed them. It was a very tense moment. I remember that driving away from the airport, I could see the corpses of victims of the death squads by the side of the road.
Cadáveres de víctimas de los llamados escuadrones de la muerte.
So what went through your mind? How did it feel in that moment?
No pensé regresar a Nicaragua porque yo en ese momento estaba muy emocionado por crear un medio de...
In spite of all this, I never thought of returning to Nicaragua because, remember, I was very excited to create this medium of communication in those conditions. It just seemed fantastic to me, the idea of such a radio. I was very enthusiastic about it. So, with this inner strength propelling me, I wasn't going to stop at anything until I reached the mountains and fulfilled my task of standing in front of a microphone and broadcasting.
De comenzar a frente un micrófono a transmitir.
Carlos would need all the strength he could muster for the path ahead. Figuring out how to set up and run a radio station off the grid and under constant threat of military attacks. But first, he'd actually have to find the guerrilla camps. And they were well hidden in the depths of the mountains and forests of the northeastern part of the country.
Bien, a mí me condujeron de la ciudad de San Salvador.
People who knew the route drove me from the capital city of San Salvador to the eastern part of El Salvador. They left me on the road where a group of young guerrillas were waiting for me. At night, we hiked into the depths of the mountains, so no one would see us. For us, city dwellers, this was a huge challenge. We didn't know how to navigate the undergrowth in the dark and tripped over all the stones. Perhaps that was the most